So, Dean, what a spirited debate that indeed was between, of course, the two Democratic challengers in this attorney general debate, this being Brian Colon and, of course, Raul Torres, the sitting Bernalillo County District Attorney, Colon being the New Mexico State Auditor. Dean, just off the top, I want to ask you, what stood out to you the most about this debate? Because certainly a lot of moments here.
Well, I think one of the things that was most interesting is that we knew going into this the vast, I mean, you couldn't find a bigger contrast between two candidates. You have Raul Torres, who went to private school here in Albuquerque, went to Harvard for undergrad, for law school, went to Stanford, one of the best law schools in the country, a career prosecutor, and then you have Brian Colon, who went to a state school. I think he went to New Mexico State, went to University of New Mexico Law, which is a solid law school, but certainly more of a homegrown candidate, and has never been a prosecutor. So he's never prosecuted a case, and he's running against Raul Torres, who has decades of experience as a prosecutor, including a federal prosecutor before he became the Bernalillo County District Attorney. So the contrast was really fascinating coming into this, and I have to say, both candidates, I think, did their best to make the most of that contrast. You had Brian Colon attacking Raul Torres's record,
right,
because he has a long record to attack, and you had Raul Torres basically looking at his opponent and saying, hey, this guy's never prosecuted a case. How can you trust him to do this job? So really, I thought the highlights really came centered around those moments where you saw the difference between these candidates and the candidates sort of take off the gloves and go at those distinctions.
Yeah, I think one of the points that stood out for me the most as we're getting a live look at on set here as both candidates kind of take their post-debate photos there with our wonderful host,
yes,
your co-anchor Jessica Garate, yes, here. I thought one of the points that really stood out to me was the call out of Raul Torres calling out Brian Colon specifically about the advertisement that Colon's campaign has used with the inclusion of Jackson Weller. That, of course, being the UNM baseball player who was murdered by Darian Bashir. Darian Bashir was convicted in court for this murder. From Raul Torres's telling of this, this was something that Jackson Weller's family has specifically requested, that Brian Colon's team campaign essentially polled the use of this advertisement with Weller. And I did want to, I'm able to pull up some of these moments here that happened between both of these candidates. So I did want to pull those up and try and play those here live on as we're kind of recapping this moment here. I do have to get these loaded up here, Dean. So
okay, so Chris, yeah, the exchange, just for those who don't know, Jackson Weller, UNM baseball player, murdered in downtown, well, not downtown, near the university, actually, in Nob Hill.
And making sure that you
shot
are...
Shot to death by Bashir. As you said, Bashir was convicted later of that crime. But this whole issue centers over the fact that Bashir was on the streets to begin with because he had been accused of shooting somebody who survived that shooting, but Bashir was never prosecuted in that case. So clearly, this is one of those cases where Brian Colon has been running ads using the image of Weller, this baseball player, saying, look, this kid was murdered,
right,
and it was because he should have been in jail. His killer should have been in jail long before this, and that is Raul Torres, the prosecutor's fault. So massive fireworks. I mean, this has been an issue that really sort of popped just in the last week in terms of that ad airing and the Weller family raising their hand and saying, please don't use the image of our son in your political ads. It's disrespectful. It's depriving us of our son of resting in peace and our family of resting in peace, and it's disgraceful. That was Raul Torres's position. And in this debate, I don't know if you have this clip,
yeah,
but he said, I think you've disqualified yourself, Mr. Colon, from public office by doing this. That's how disgusting it was. So he really went at this.
Yeah.
And he had publicly called, along with the Weller family, for the Colon camp to take this ad down. Colon camp did not. They said, no, this is politics and this happened and we're going to use this as an example of Torres's failure in this case.
Right.
Now, so do you want to play the clip? Do you have
that?
Yeah,
I do have not the specific part that you were talking about, but this is basically, I pulled a piece from both Torres and Colon sort of responding in all fairness here. So we'll play this right here.
Would ignore that call by Patrick Weller and use his pain
to advance your political cause and your political agenda. You can try and lie and mislead people about my record all you want, but shame on you for misusing the image of a dead boy to advance your political agenda. You owe the Weller family an apology, and you're better than that.
Mr. Colon.
And we got a response here from as well, Brian Colon's campaign here. Let me just load this one up.
Okay.
Him as well, sort of casting that shame, he said, right back at essentially Raul Torres for treatment of this case. So here we go. I'll play this.
The judge admonished you for failing to appropriately prosecute the case that was thrown out before Mr. Weller had to bury his son. Now, I took no joy in that. But what I also know is that I took no joy in having my opponent misrepresent my record. I take no joy in knowing that two 25-year-olds will never go home to their families because of the botched work that was done in Mr. Torres' district attorney office. Look, we're going to talk a lot about those cases tonight, but let me just say this. I am sorry for Mr. Weller's loss, but I'm deeply sorry also for the community's loss. As a Lobo myself, I felt that pain. I understood what it was to be at the exact location where that man was shot.
And but yes, you don't, he'll never you don't, be, look, you don't feel,
let you
don't
finish
feel the
your
pain enough.
Feigned indignation, Raul, let me finish.
Gentlemen.
Mine. And I'll just say this, if he had done his job, if he had prosecuted the case the first time appropriately and not had to have the judge throw it out and then not have it refiled and then have him commit another crime, we wouldn't be having this conversation about this today. And yes, I do care about my son. And yes, I can only imagine that pain of Mr. Weller. Had he called me, I would have taken his call. But instead, he went and released a video, which was really a campaign ad. So at the end of the day, I wish...
We'll stop it right there. But that was, I thought it was remarkable, Brian Colon calling that feigned indignation, essentially, from Raul Torres. Just a really interesting moment, because I think it speaks a lot to the work that somebody does as a top prosecutor, right? You're dealing with life and death cases, and so... That's a pretty big thing to say to somebody, to say that it is it's sort of fake outrage, so to speak. With
yeah,
this, so.
Look, in this case, Raul Torres, now that we've explained a little bit for the viewers the context of what happened with this case, and maybe we should make sure those details are clear. So mm-hmm. Jackson Weller is killed by this man who was involved in an earlier crime for which he was never prosecuted. Now, Raul Torres's explanation is, yes, we did not prosecute him on that case because we couldn't get the witnesses to come forward and as part of the pretrial preparation for this case. So that case did fall by the side, but not because it was our fault. But we had asked that this Bashir gentleman be locked up pending another case because he had been charged with shooting from a car, I think, in the vicinity of police officers. And at the time, they had asked the judge to lock him up until trial in that case. So Raul Torres's position is essentially, look, we did our best with the first case, and he was already up for a second case, during which we asked the judge in this case to keep him locked up, and he should have been off the streets, and that's not our fault. So that's the context. Mm-hmm. And Chris, you're absolutely right. Raul Torres went for the throat on this one, said, how dare you? You know, you've disqualified yourself for public office by doing this. You know, please, you know, listen to this family and don't use the image of their dead son for your political gain. And Chris, I agree with you. It was shocking a little bit to see how quickly Colon turned this around and said, oh, well, now you're the one that's using this for your political gain. And he also, I thought it was a bit of a stretch. He said, well, I've been in that area, as though standing on the corner, you know, I mean, he's being accused of using this image inappropriately and not respecting the rights of the family, but he's saying, but I feel their pain because I've been in that area before and I'm a Lobo. I went to UN, you know, I mean,
so
that I thought was a little strange
in that area.
But I think he did. I think on some level he did something to minimize the attack from Colon on that. I mean, from Torres on that. I think he did. He gained some ground in terms of sort of neutralizing that attack, I thought.
Yeah. One of the interesting topics I felt as well, and this is where I think a lot of the debate kind of veered back into when we talk about record is pretrial detention.
Mm-hmm.
I know, Brian Colon seemed to have quite the focus here this evening on saying that, Raul Torres's record shows that he has not been an effective prosecutor with the rules that are in place. although Cologne did seem to agree there needs to be some level of adjustment here. Mm-hmm. But meanwhile, you know, Raul Torres is trying to bring it back to, look, essentially calling Brian Cologne a career politician or a politico, somebody who's weaved in and out behind the scenes, has always been seeking public office, and hasn't actually rolled up his sleeves to get involved in the work, and highlighting that, you know, Brian Cologne wasn't there during the pretrial detention debate that happened in Santa Fe, even though there was no law that came out of it. And so I just thought that those were some pretty big moments here tonight, was in that context of pretrial detention. Did anything stand out to you, Dean, about this conversation that they argument, rather, that they were really having about what to do about pretrial detention? Because it seemed like Torres had some specifics. Cologne kept coming back to a general idea, seemingly, of everybody working together, getting the partners here going, and, mm-hmm. and whatnot. What were your thoughts?
Well, I think it's interesting because it does go back to the contrast between these two. One's a career prosecutor. The other has been in public life for a number of decades, but right. he is a lawyer by training and by trade, but has run for a number of offices. He ran for lieutenant governor and lost. He ran for the mayor of Albuquerque and lost. Right. He ran for auditor, which he's serving as now, and then is now running for attorney general. And that was the criticism that Raul Torres was launching, saying, look, don't tell me you've been in public service for 20 years. You've just been running for office for 20 years, and that's different.
Right.
I've been in public service because I'm a prosecutor, and I've actually rolled up my sleeves and done this job.
Right.
Now, in terms of bail reform, I thought it was fascinating because you did, if you listen closely, and I always love when this happens in debates, you sort of you get the subtext a little bit, right? Mm. So at the legislature, Raul Torres was fighting very hard for rebuttable presumption of detention, which means, look, we've done away with, you know, we've done bail reform, so there's no longer just, you know, you get locked up and you can't get out until you get them. Everyone gets out unless we can show that they're dangerous and they need to stay behind bars until their trial. That's the way things work now, right? That's what we've come to. And Torres essentially, along with some other folks at the legislature, was campaigning hard and fighting hard, along with Mayor Keller, who they share the same, you know, they share the same values on this issue, fighting hard for a rebuttable presumption of detention, which means basically there are some people for whom they should have to show us they can get out, right? There should be a presumption that this person is dangerous, and they should have to show us why we should trust them outside of jail until their trial. So that's the issue. It was only a 30-day session. No law got passed on that issue. And in the battle over this, they both seem to agree that that's important. But in the battle over this, Raul Torres was saying, look, I see you at the roundhouse during the session. You're glad-handing. You're, you know, and Brian Cologne has been heavily involved in the Democratic politics for decades now. So these are his friends and his compatriots. And so he's, you know, his relationships throughout the roundhouse, especially during the legislative session, that's sort of what's going on. They're visiting and talking.
Right.
And Raul Torres says, but I never heard you speak up on this issue.
Right.
You're
right.
not a leader. You didn't stand up and say, this is important. We need to get it done. And then when it doesn't get done, there's no responsibility. So that was, I thought, an interesting attack that Raul Torres made on Cologne, saying, you know, you talk about relationships and you talk about having been in public life, but what's it worth if you're up there and you won't even fight for this very specific thing that we think we need to do to get crime down?
Yeah, Torres saying specifically, some of the notes I had here, I saw Brian at the roundhouse taking selfies. I never heard him speak up. Mm-hmm. I get it. It's a difficult issue.
Yeah, it's a good line.
You know, yeah. And you know, certainly I know from spending a couple opening days at the roundhouse, the first days really are a chance when a lot of lawmakers are coming back together and, sharing a lot of photos with themselves, a lot of hugs, it's good to see you, that kind of stuff. And so I think Torres certainly highlighting, trying to say, look, that's not me. I'm going up there to roll up the sleeves, do the work, and calling Brian Cologne out for obviously somebody who's had a number of years in the political scene.
And Chris Cologne's rebuttal, we should make note of, was essentially, well, Mr. Torres, even though you have a relationship with MLG, with the governor, Michelle Lujan Grisham, and also with Keller, Mayor Keller on this, you still didn't get it done, so that's on you. And I thought that was interesting that he came back at him and said, well, you know, you didn't get it done either, basically. And then Torres, if you listen closely, was sort of talking about the fact that his party, because at the end of the day, the Democrats didn't get this done. The Democrats didn't have the votes for rebuttable presumption of detention.
Right.
And Torres says, you know, the party has to face this. So he said this. It wasn't an attack directly at Cologne, but he was basically saying, look, we're Dems, and we're not facing this issue in a way that's responsible and in the way that it needs to be faced, and we're not talking about it. And he's talking about, I think, a lack of will among enough Democrats at the Roundhouse that held back this legislation.
Yeah.
So there was a jab there at the party and a sort of a raising his hand and saying, look, we should have been able to get this done, and at some point our party can't be the party of not doing this and getting this important crime legislation passed.
Right, because of course, if we do look at the makeup of the legislature, it is essentially a supermajority for the Democratic Party. They have control of the House, they have control of the Senate, and they also have the governor's office. And so they certainly have recognized that power, I think, in years past. I recall that Speaker Brian Egolf specifically had a term for stuff that they wanted to get through the Democratic Party in the immediate first days of the session, calling it a rocket docket. So
right.
You know that there is a level of power there, but just to what extent are they willing to go is the big question. I think that's an interesting place where Torres and Colon diverge, because you heard some of Torres's attacks specifically, and I think Brian Colon called this out. He said it was straight out of the Republican playbook. But one of the things that he had called out was the use of defund the police, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the conversation topics that kept coming up, kept weaving back in there, is that Torres is saying, you know, my opponent has pushed to defund the police. He attacked him, saying that, you know, he's talked about this on his podcast, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
And again, Colon saying that's right out of the Republican playbook. Communities of color are hurting, and, you know, we owe it to folks to be able to listen and make changes that are, shifting how this area of government works, essentially. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was another moment, some of those moments that stood out for me in terms of that bringing up of defund the police, because, you know, this is a Democratic primary debate, and usually that is a issue that cuts along that Democrat-Republican line there.
Right, and this is not something that just came up at the debate. I mean, for those who may have not seen the ads, Raul Torres has been running ads against Colon, where Colon is on camera saying we should defund the police.
Right.
So it's an attack line that he's already made. Mm-hmm. He highlighted again tonight during this debate, which I thought was interesting. And certainly Colon defended, saying, I never meant that, I never said that, I never, you know, you've pieced together different things I've said and made it sound like I want to defund the police. And Colon was very specific in saying, I have never said that. I don't think it's, you know, we should defund the police. That's not my position. And I think as they talked, you got down a little more to the nuance,
mm-hmm.
of the fact that Colon has talked about, we should talk to the public about what it means to defund the police, because there is this idea that, well, it doesn't mean we're just going to take all the money away from the police. It means that we're going to try to use our resources in different ways, right, to help communities of color or poor communities so that there's more equitable treatment in neighborhoods, that sort of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think we got during the debate a little bit of the truth of that. And I thought it was interesting. You know what Raul Torres' reply was? He's like, well, it's irresponsible during a crime wave to even say that.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't, as a public leader holding a statewide office, even be talking about stuff like that. You should not be using that terminology at all right now when solving crime is such a priority. So I thought that was interesting, where we sort of finally, I mean, I walked away from the debate with a little more clarity about that entire issue and where they were both coming from, I think.
Yeah, and I did want to bring up as well some of the sound that we had, or some of the moments.
Let's
here.
Let's hear it. Let's hear it. Let's play some highlights, Chris.
Let's show us get some highlights. To it. Here we go. I'm going to flop over to
roll
this
the video
side
tape.
Here. We'll roll the tape.
He said that we need to educate the public about what we mean when we say defund the police. He then goes on to say that we need to reallocate resources away from the police to other agencies. That's the wrong thing to do. That's the last thing that we need to do. We live in a community that has at least 300 officers short from what we need on the streets of Albuquerque. And we have a shortage of officers across the state. We can't have somebody who's the chief law enforcement officer in this state advocating to defund the police the way Brian has. And I know he wants to talk about creating space for other people to have a conversation. He did that in his podcast, which was part of his daily routine as the state auditor, while those of us who were actually trying to fight crime were rolling up our sleeves and doing the hard and difficult work. I know it's easy to sit on the sidelines and listen to ideas like defunding the police that are politically popular in one moment, but that's the wrong thing to do. It's a dangerous idea, and it needs to be rejected out of hand.
Look, this.
That again being Raul Torres' response towards the idea of what happens when you're talking about defunding the police and why he's attacked Brian Colon related to that. His belief basically being that it is irresponsible to talk about that during a crime wave.
You know, Chris, one thing that's come out of this debate that I thought was interesting is Brian Colon coming into this doesn't have any experience as a prosecutor, right, and chose to say that's not a big deal. I'm fine. I can run basically a prosecutor's office without ever having been a prosecutor. I have relationships. I've been a statewide leader. I have relationships with different people around the state. And I thought he did a fair job of just sort of deflecting his lack of experience and saying the other experience that I have, connections. And as I said, he has relationships. He's been in politics for a long time in New Mexico. He's been a leader within the Democratic Party. So certainly there's probably some truth to the fact that he has relationships. The question, I think, for the voters will be, are those relationships more important or as important as having been a lifelong prosecutor?
Right.
And just going back to that, I mean, that at the end of the day, I think that's one of the biggest issues. We can talk about Jackson Weller, the UNM baseball player. We can talk about bail reform. But that really remains in this campaign the major issues. You know, Colon, going back to Raul Torres saying, well, you haven't been in public service for 20 years. You've been running for office for 20 years, but that's different than being in public service. You know, yeah. You ran for lieutenant governor. You ran for the mayor of Albuquerque when that position was open. You ran for auditor. And then, of course, on the other side, mm-hmm. I think Brian Colon did a fair job of attacking Raul Torres as someone who has lost cases or cases have slipped through the cracks, or he hasn't done, his rate of prosecution isn't as high as it should be. Those sorts of things, saying, well, I'll be better than a failed prosecutor. So I thought that posture was probably a pretty smart posture for him throughout this debate, and I thought he sold it pretty well.
Yeah, and this being, in all fairness, wanting to play a part of Brian Colon's response in that exchange there that we just heard from, we'll roll this.
Roll the videotape, Chris.
Roll the tape as I am loading things up here. So here we go.
You're doing a disservice to them and to the community at large. What Raul has been saying has not been working. He's botched cases, he's a failed prosecutor, and frankly, he's taken shots at me that are just for political gain.
And
at the end of the day, it makes him maybe a good politician.
With that, we're going to go on to our next question. This one is specifically for Mr. Torres. The Legislative Finance Committee analyst released a report earlier this year that found an accountability gap.
All right, that was Brian Colon's response there to Raul Torres. Dean, you were just talking about, you think there's going to be a question voters maybe will have to ask themselves before picking a contestant?
I think they will. I think this is going to be an important part, whether it's a conscious decision or whether it's just, as voting sometimes is just a gut thing. Yeah. You heard Brian Colon saying to Raul Torres, you are a failed prosecutor. So I think at the end of the day, you are going to have some voters who are going to have to decide, is Raul Torres really a failed prosecutor? Because one thing you do know about Raul Torres is the entire time he's been prosecutor in Bernalillo County, he has been very vocal. He has been in front of the camera. He has been trying to show the issues, trying to push for reform of the bail reform. And so one of the questions is going to be, is he a failed prosecutor, or are the problems that have come to light a function of a broken system that needs to be fixed that have nothing to do with his expertise or his work or his efforts?
Yeah.
And it could, I'm not saying it has to be one or the other, but that is clearly, I think, something that if you really believe the system is broken and you say Raul Torres, any voter could say, oh, but Raul Torres is a good prosecutor and he's doing what he can in spite of a broken system. Or if you're Brian Colon, you're saying, look, we can do way better than this guy did. His track record doesn't, doesn't show us someone that we should trust as the Attorney General. So I think that's just an interesting question, is who's, you know, we all know we have a crime problem, so whose responsibility is it?
Yeah, and I think this is a really interesting race because, yeah, it does pit, as you're saying, the dynamics between somebody who has certainly been out there far, far more vocal about all of the changes, and he says problems that existed in the Bernalillo County District Attorney's Office, and that is versus, you know, somebody who has, yeah, exactly, run in a lot of different political races his entire career. So it kind of draws into that question, though, about, I think for some voters may ask, you know, where are we going with Brian Colon? And whereas when you see Raul Torres's, I guess you could say resume, yeah, he has been a career prosecutor and whatnot, but while Brian Colon is a lawyer, as Raul Torres pointed out, he has not prosecuted a parking ticket, he says, essentially. Even
yeah, it was a pretty good line.
Yeah,
All things considered,
that was a pretty intense one. To note that whoever does win this Democratic primary, they will have to face the Republican challenger. That is Jeremy Gay. He is running unopposed for the Republicans in the June 2022 primary. And also, just to give you kind of a look at where elections are headed, early voting, it actually starts tomorrow. That is, you'll start seeing those polling places open up, and then absentee ballots might start hitting the mail very soon. And then, of course, you've got the primary election itself the day of, Tuesday, June 7th, and then the general election that comes on November 8th. So,
Chris, I don't want to do a disservice to the Republican candidate for Attorney General, but we should acknowledge, I think, that whoever wins the Democratic primary will be the presumptive favorite in terms of the general election. So this is right. This is really, some people consider this the general election right now because these people have such name recognition, war chests in terms of funding, that sort of thing. So whoever comes out of this is going to be a formidable opponent for the Republican in this race.
Indeed, and of course, for the folks who are maybe forgetting, Hector Balderas, he is the current Attorney General, has been for two terms. He is term limited, so that's why you're not seeing his name in this race here again. Mm-hmm. And of course, as Dean, I think you alluded to, there have been very few Attorney Generals, Republican Attorney Generals in New Mexico over the last several years. I wish I could pull up the stats right in front of me, but it is very significantly has been a race for the Democrats to basically lose. Essentially, it is their race to lose, so to speak, as the phrase goes.
Historically, that's a fair assessment.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, Dean, we appreciate you joining us here on KRQE.com. For those of you who are maybe watching and wondering, why are they on the internet live streaming? This is what we like to do now.
We can't help ourselves. help ourselves. We want to be on your computer.
That's right. On your cell phone as well.
Yeah.
We know a lot of people are watching here. And we encourage you folks to download the KRQE News app. We send alerts out when we're doing these live streams. We try to do more of them, especially around political season
yes.
when we're hosting debates. And just getting a lot more analysis, ways for you to help understand the races here and the story, and hope that you got a little bit something out of our analysis here tonight after being able to watch this great debate. So, Dean, any last thoughts? We appreciate you joining us here, but any last thoughts?
Just a big thanks to our viewers who watched it live. Thanks to our viewers watching us debrief about this. And great job, Jess. I thought Jess handled herself very well.
Yeah, especially
as the moderator.
Yes, and especially in a debate when you think about, man, how many times they went off topic.
Yeah.
they could not help themselves from attacking
cats.
Each other. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. So, well, we appreciate it, and to both of the candidates for participating here. Couldn't do it without them agreeing to the terms of our debate here. So we appreciate that, and hope that y'all have a good rest of your night. Of course, if you want to check out the entire debate, we will post it here on KRQE.com. And Dean, you'll be back at KRQE News 13 at 10 with some a whole wrap-up of the debates, tonight's debates, big moments.
Every night, Chris.
For sure.
And
that's
again
right.
tonight. We'll do that.
Right on. Well,
Thank
thanks
you.
Again. We appreciate you watching.
You bet.